Okay, welcome to live case session one, TAVR from Asan Medical Center. I'm H.S. Kim from SNU Hospital, South Korea, and my co-chair of this live session is Dr. Alan C. Young from Stanford, USA. Where is Myungi Hong? Okay.
Great, so our first session will be from Asan Medical Center, so let's go ahead and introduce the center. Good afternoon, SJ. We are obviously here, and we have a very distinguished panel here with Dr. Chen, Dr. Chang, Dr. Dawkins, Dr. Guan, Dr. Shi, Dr. Cao, and Dr. Codelli, and Dr. Taggart, and Dr. Young. So I think we're going to start with this TAVR session. So maybe you can introduce the team for us and the case. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's really happy to. I have some first session from the Asan Medical Center. Actually, Dr. Yun, Dr. Gang, Yun is a major contributor of TAVR procedure in our hospital. Actually, we prepared two cases. First one is we're going to use the S3 device, and the second one we're going to show Evolut R, a device procedure. So, Dr. Yun, you want to start with first case presentation.
Hi, the patient is 82 years male, and with symptomatic severe aortic stenosis with a normal LV systolic function. Next slide, please. Actually, the patient had not specific comorbidities, so the ST score is estimated about 2. So according to the STS, the classification, the patient classified as a low to intermediate risk score. Next slide. So as already I previously explained, the patient ejection fraction is normal and no significant aortic regurgitation or mitral regurgitation at baseline. Next slide. Okay, next slide. And the patient had the enough adequate size of the iliofemoral artery. Next slide. So this is the important measurements, CT measurements of the aortic aneurysm. So as you can see, the patient, the short and long diameter was 23 and 28 millimeter.
23, the longest one 28, right?
Longest is 28. Mm-hmm. And the basically the sapient bowel expandable bowel was measurement was based on the aortic aneurysm area. So this patient aortic aneurysm area was 520 millimeter square. Next slide. And also we now measure the all structure of the aortic valve complex. So for example, sinus valsalva, the area is more than 1,000. And this is compared to relatively larger than the average patients. Next slide. And this is also very important findings. So patient calcium volume was measured as a 580 millimeters square. And according to our database, the average calcium volume was 400. So this patient have a relatively moderate or severe calcified leaflets. And the most calcified leaflet was non-coronary cusp. Okay, next slide. So this is a device size selection chart. So if you look at the left row, so the size, if you choose the 26 millimeter valve, the area oversizing was 80%, which means the 20% undersize is too small. And if you use the 26, it means that area oversizing 102.6%. So this is the almost just size, and this is the optimal size for the Sapien 3. Next slide. Okay. So, and the coronal height is the enough.
Show us first picture. First picture. All right.
So, maybe we can discuss quickly that this is a low risk patient. I think David Taggart is in the panel. Is this something we should do, or we should just you can get it done in mini thoracotomy, something changed about quickly?
In the UK just now, this patient would definitely have conventional surgical aortic valve replacement because he is a good 82, good ventricle, low risk patient. But one has to say, as we look at the results of PARTNER 2A and the 3-year results of the core valve investigators in the US, they're showing quite clearly that for even intermediate risk patients, there's now lower mortality and lower risk of stroke with percutaneous valve replacement. So I think increasingly in the UK, we will do these patients also with percutaneous valve replacements.
Wow, David, that's really a fresh thing to hear from you, meaning before ACC, you'll be saying, what the heck are you guys doing? This should be surgical, right?
Sorry to disappoint.
Wow, okay, so.
But David, this is a very low-risk patient, STS 2.08%.
Yes.
But can we extrapolate the PARTNER 2A trial to this group of low-risk patients? The PARTNER 2A, the mean STS score is 5.8%, which is intermediate risk.
That's right. I don't think we would do it just now, but I think that's the direction of travel, is that into lower risk populations. And I have to say that even for a good 82-year-old, I mean, the projected mortality from surgery in this case would be less than 2% for death or stroke. But it would still take most 80-year-olds six weeks to 3 months to get over the operation.
Yeah.
So there, I think there's a major advantage of the percutaneous approach in terms of speed of recovery.
I think the issue is if you're going to do these patients, the anatomy, it depends on the risk of TAVR, right? We keep talking about what is the surgical risk, right? If this person's surgical risk is 2%, but the risk of TAVR we feel is 5%, then they shouldn't get TAVR. So if the vascular access is good, the annulus anatomy is good, the calcification patterns are good, we have to start looking at it. I agree, at 82. We have to start looking at what is the risk of TAVR, what is the risk of surgery, patient preference factors in. And the questions that we're going to ask, the benchmark should be a 1% mortality, a 1% major stroke rate. If we don't think we can achieve it, I agree with David, this patient should have surgery. And I think that's how we need to approach it. The one thing here that's a little bit concerning is the calcium pattern. There's almost fusion of the left and right with the heavy calcium and bulky calcium on the known coronary cusp. These are the ones that, these sinuses are large enough, so I don't think it's an issue, but if the sinuses were somewhat effaced, these are the ones I worry about with this degree that you get asymmetric expansion and potentially root injury.
Yeah, so, I mean, I didn't see the CT that well in terms of looking at really CT. The leaflets, does it really looks like it's fused or something? I couldn't tell
that
well.
It's hard to say with certainty, but an echo would help answer that as
I
well.
I agree. So. But I think, it's obviously this has to be absolutely TF. I mean, this patient somehow has more access. You wouldn't be talking about, doing TAVR, right?
Correct.
And I think, the femoral access in terms of the dimension as well as tortuosity and other sort of concentric calcification, big role. Any other comments before we see what SJ going to do? Paul, anything? Is that something we're going to do in Taiwan as well?
Well, the patient has to pay for himself. But, yeah, why not?
I saw that there was you didn't do angiography before. Is that do you look at the CT to look at the coronaries, or do you not do routine coronaries before, or?
No, we didn't do that.
Yeah.
It's just the CT angiogram.
CT angiogram looks at that.
Yeah, but we didn't do the aortogram and coronary angiogram too. Okay, David, talk about, this is low risk patients. So we have large registry data, including the European Caucasian, TAVR registry data, almost 3,000 something. And we separate with Asian TAVR procedures and Caucasian TAVR procedures. Absolutely, totally different, clinical characteristics is, Even 82 years, mean age is very old, quite the same with Asian peoples and Caucasian peoples. However, in the clinical comorbidity concern is characteristics is totally different, right? So Dr. Yun, you got some data, so briefly explain that.
Yeah, I made a presentation yesterday briefly, so as Dr. Park mentioned, the TAVR started early in the European countries, so the population, TAVR population in Europe is very more comorbidities than Asian patients. So the outcome is also improving according to their time. So however, overall the comorbidities, the estimated surgical risk is similar. However, due to the accumulated evidence and experience so far, so the outcome of TAVR is better in Asian than Caucasian.
All right, so we want to start, you know, in order to save the time, so we have already, would you show the next slide? And the ample latitude guider, so with a little bit stiff wire, and we pass the, across the stenotic aortic valve, and next. And so we did balloon predilation, so using the 23 millimeters, or inflate, pacing, and contrast injection is perfectly, you know, fitting the 23 size of balloon. However, still the coronary, you know, long diameter is bigger than that. And so, recently, so we tried the, just a direct device placement without predilation. However, particularly these cases, we have already done free dilation with the 23 balloon. Sorry. And we're going to try the SS3 device already mapping with the 26. We have discussed a lot about the device size. We have our own, you know, size selection algorithms. So with
now we are pushing the system, whole system.
All right. And so push out the whole system from the right. And Dr. Yun, would you explain that, what happened?
So the Sapien 3 was recently launched in the Asian countries. So there, I'd like to briefly introduce the new system. So can you see this?
Yes, we can see your hand.
So there is a new feature, the unlocking system. And the color is different, but the most important the point is this one. So first we need to unlock the system like this. You can see the unlock marker. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Too small, okay?
Go ahead.
And then we should pull back the whole system.
As show the floor as well, yeah. So the balloon is being pulled back into the the valve.
Right.
Be careful the position with the wire.
Okay, good.
And we saw the additional marker in here. Right. Can you see that?
Yes. Okay. It's good also to be a little bit of cranial view to see the sort of completely sort of perpendicular profile of the stent valve, so you know that you're absolutely inside with those markers.
Okay. And then the fine tuning. Now I'm turning the counterclockwise, so you can see the adjustment. So more. So there's a
fine tuning. It's okay. I think it's okay. Perfect.
How do you think that?
Wiring a little bit. And okay, we have already free dilation. And
it's time to go up.
Push the system. And
so you're rotating the dial to flex the sheath system.
Please.
Smoothly,
easily. All right. So, let's just show that.
Same time, please.
Contrast, please.
Pull the pusher back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. And unlock status again. Okay. And we're gonna a little bit the yard up here. Okay. The pusher pulled out here. Okay.
Okay. Make sure the lock again. And then lock again for the further fine-tuning.
Okay, test please.
Are you back to the deployment view at this point, I presume, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, now already the perpendicular view, RL2 and cutout 30.
All right, so.
So you want to do a 50-50, right?
Yes, 50-50. However, a little bit different thing is with the XT system, so we have some central dot with the system. And so they recommended, test please. They recommended a little bit higher positioning of a central dot. However, you know, during the inflation, we can accommodate.
What do you think about
the
positions issue?
I think it looks good. The dot just above the edges.
Yeah.
I think it looks good.
It's good.
Yep. So again, the deployment is always very slow. You can have a little adjustment if you think slips.
Okay.
And you have TE probe in as well.
Okay, I will check again. Okay, test again. Okay, I think it's good.
Yeah.
All right, here we are. So we're gonna, okay, pacing.
Pacing on.
Injection.
Contrast. Okay.
Okay.
Inflate.
Slowly.
Slow, yeah.
Okay. Why not? Good. Perfect. Five. And
pacing off.
Pacing off, please. Put the system out.
So it's a good angle. You can see the valve was deployed pretty much perpendicular to the annulus.
Actually, you know, the total different thing is, you know, distal part of a stent strut is, you know, shorting. Almost a six millimeter, eight millimeters in the case, depending on a different size. And so, actually, we didn't do general analysis in almost all cases. However, today, actually, we have some. We're going to show that transesophageal echo monitoring. Dr. Ho, will you explain that or something? What about there?
So, is the pressure a little low, or is it coming up now?
Right. Why is inside?
Okay, good. So is it a nominal prep for this S3? Is it nominal volume?
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Just a 2% over area over stretching. What do you think, Dr. Hall? Will you show that? Could you explain that? The paravalvular regurgitation or something?
So there's only mild paravalvular leakage on the posterior side. And otherwise, it looks good, well deployed, without any acute complication.
Can I just make one point? That's a great view. If you look in that sinus there, it's full. It almost looks like the root is tented a little bit by the calcium. And I think, those are, risk-benefit discussions. I think this looks like a great result. So,
okay, I want to take your electrograms in the wire inside here. Okay, take a picture first, and then gonna evaluate. I think it's good.
A little mild.
Can you see the TE in the cross sectional view?
Should you be concerned to put a little bit more volume, a cc or so, to inflate this a little bit more, given it's only 2% over?
That's the infection.
Okay, depending on
echo finding.
Part of valvular regurgitation is more than mild, and so we're going to do that a little bit, high volume, so once is more or something.
Because I think from the NGO, the AI seems to be transvalvular instead of PVL.
Now you have
a wire inside, so probably with the wire out, it will look better.
I think the echo really helps.
Okay.
Do you enlarge the echo view to see the presence of paravalvular leakage?
How about the echo findings?
This looks good.
Fine. Mainly, I think it's mainly central, right?
Yeah.
Not too much
paravalvular.
But mainly central.
Maybe central.
Station. Okay, we're going to remove the wires. Why not?
It's helpful to go up and down the valve a little bit, because sometimes you might see some paravalvular leak.
The only thing on the echo is I would just make sure you're looking in the sinuses, so you're not going to see the AR there. Right. You want to go lower at the base of the frame, right at the angular level. And I think biplane on the echo is useful for that.
It's important to scan the whole valves up and down, because if sometimes you see too much, it's actually flare, it's sort of the spraying of the AI, and if you don't go the wrong direction, you may see nothing. So if you use TE, you want to really sort of look through the valve carefully.
Okay, actually, the ultrasound showed a mild. I think it's mild. The regurgitation. We're gonna wait for 3 minutes, 4 minutes. Anyways, I believe degree of paravalvular regurgitation is getting decreased, right?
There's absolutely a tendency of reduced leakage when we wait for about
5 minutes because the outward skirt will expand and seal the leakage.
Right, in terms of a position of device, actually, you know, ratio of upper part and below the coronary sinus is 80, 20, and 75, something. And so I think it's a position-wise, it's very perfect, you know, positioning. And probably regurgitation is after the smile. And we're going to wait for 5 minutes more. And during that time, we're going to move a second care lab. Dr. An will show the second case first. And later, you're going to show the another aortogram, right?
So, okay. One quick question, SG. So, SJ, so what kind of anesthesia this person have? Is it under general or?
General, so for the demonstration, right? Right, the transsexual fascia.
And also, what wire did you use for this S3? It's like a comforter wire. It looks like it is not an extra support.
You mean
What wire did you use to deliver the valve?
Wire, extra support from super stiff wire.
That's a preference. Yeah.
I think that wire is Safri wire, is it?
No, it's not a Safri.
Maybe make it a lot of curves.
I don't like it.
Safri wire.
So okay, we're trying to make like a Safri wire. Just
second color.
Great. Any comments from the operator about this?
Okay.
Okay. Okay, Eberhardt and Dr. An, I recognize Eberhardt's glasses. Can you see okay in the cath lab with that?
Yes, no, I can see you. You're killing Dr. Holm.
They match his scrubs. Yeah.
Perfect shades of blue, the hat and the glasses and your scrubs and a mask. So please go ahead and tell us what you plan to do.
Okay. Good afternoon, Dr. Holm, Dr. Kim, Dr. Alan Young, and audience. I'm Dr. An from Assam Medical Center. My beside is Dr. Grube, the one of the master of TAVR procedure nowadays. It's my honor to be with you, and Dr. Lee, my colleague. I will briefly introduce to the patient the brief history. This is a 91-year-old gentleman admitted with DOE, started 6 months ago. He had a history of hypertension. Echocardiography showed the severe aortic stenosis. Next.
Okay.
Yes. Here's a coronary risk factors are hypertension and excess smokers. SDS score is 5, Euro score is 10, Euro score 2 is 3. This is actual partner 2 trial patient, old age but intermediate risk patient. Last week we did the cardiac catheterization. We found a significant stenosis at the left main. Next. This is a coronary angiogram for this patient and last week. And this is the echo finding. Next. The peripheral is good. Right side is 7.1, left side is 6.7. So we will choose the right side approach. Next. This is annulus parameters. Annulus short diameter is 19.7, long diameter is 25.8, mean diameter is 22.8, annulus area is 400, perimeter is 72, and perimeter-driven diameter is 23. Sinus Valsalva size is big, area is 800, sinus tubular junction is big as well, 740 square millimeter. Next. Calcium is, this patient have a severe calcification. Our median calcium volume is 400. So this patient, 700, is above the median value. This is our chart. Right side is the chart for Everett R. The 26, the 12% oversize. 29 is 25% oversize. This patient have a very short height of left coronary artery. Left coronary artery height is just 7.8, and right coronary is 17.8. that this is the best view.
First of all, thank you very much, SJ and the team. SJ is leaving, he's depressed. And I want to thank everyone here again to have me for the live transmission. I've done several cases with my friend here, the left, Dr. Ahn. He's a great operator and he will be leading the case. I will be supporting him. And I see in the panel a lot of good friends, all the experts there. So if you have seen the case and maybe the angiogram, maybe we can discuss a couple of points, just a few things important. We can discuss the choice of device in this case. We can discuss the amount of calcification. We can discuss the takeoff of the left. Is there any precaution to be taken? And also interesting here is, the patient does have fairly severe AI, so we are dealing with a diastolic pressure around 30 with and that hasn't changed over time here. The diastolic pressure is between 30 and 39. So this is maybe an important aspect for the follow-up and post-implant. So is there anything that, from your side that needs to be discussed?
In addition, this patient have a severe coronary artery disease.
Right, can we see the coronary angiogram again? We didn't see that.
The coronary angiogram.
Is it possible?
Can we see the
angiogram? I can show you.
Coronary angiogram.
Yeah, the first one.
First.
So this is not the left main here. Dr. Ahn, you did the case.
This is obviously not pre. Yeah.
Okay, this is a pre coronary angiogram. Actually, this looks like the left main, but this is not true left main. The left side is the LAD, and right side is the circumflex artery and high OM. So very big, very huge left side coronary artery, but very tight stenosis. It looks like left main.
But the LAD is taking off, as you can see, a little proximal to the catheter.
Yeah.
So that's the left main. And then he took care of the huge, large system by stenting the system beforehand.
Same setting, or is it when it was done before this TAVR procedure?
That's another interesting question, coronary heart disease and aortic stenosis. I guess here it was decided to do the case staged, so they did the coronary, and now we are dealing with the valve.
Dr. Grube, this is Guan, Dr. Guan.
Right. Yes.
From the Samsung Medical Center. So my question is that I'd like to ask about the device selection for specific anatomy. In this patient, the coronary, the left coronary ostium is lower than other patients. And that's why you select Evolal. And beside that, can you tell us a little bit about how to select the one specific device among the three different devices available in Korea, the Sapien, CoValve, and the Lotus Valve?
Yeah, so I don't know who would you like first. I mean, I can give you my perspective, but maybe you can. Okay, so here, Professor Guan, basically any user that experienced with either one valve will tell you we can do it this way. We can do it with an Edwards, we can do it with the Lotus, and we can do it with the CoValve. If we have the three available, my personal choice would be in a low coronary setting, would be CoValve. The reason being that you have a chance to correct. You don't have to really pay that much attention to the takeoff, and in case something happens, you can always resheath and pull back. Now, you can do the same with Lotus, but with Lotus, you would like to implant as high as possible, which might limit the amount above the valve, or the distance above the valve. And with Edwards, well, as you've seen, you know, you can do it, but I think the best choice for me here, given the three options, would be CoreValve with the least danger of hurting the takeoff.
Eberhard, I yes. totally agree with you that the choice would be Evolut R because the instance of coronary obstruction is least compared yeah. with the other two competitors. But how do you approach, in this case, do you pre-engage the coronary catheter, guiding catheter on the left coronary artery, and then implant Evolut R, or just implant Evolut R?
Yeah, this is an excellent question, and obviously I'm a guest operator here, so let me tell you what we would do. First of all, looking at the anatomy, we can say it is a big anatomy. It's a large annulus, it's a large sinus and the junction, so I really don't think, I don't expect anyway, that anything would happen to the ostium of the left. So having said that, you can do two things. You can say a very pragmatic approach. You can say every coronary that has less than 10 millimeter or less than 1 centimeter, you protect no matter what. And then there are different ways to protect. You can put the guide in, you can put the wire in, you can put the balloon in, you can put the balloon and stent in. So these are all options. Personally, giving a low chance of obstruction here, in my practice or our practice, we would probably protect with the left AL or Judkins. I'm sorry, with the Judkins, and then you know put the wire down only, no stent and no balloon. So with the low chance that anything happens, you at least have access. Now, we discussed this beforehand, and the team here preferred, given the low chance of obstruction, to have the access ready, deploy the valve, two-thirds, a little more, see whether the flow is okay. If the flow is okay, then we deploy the valve. If there's any if there's any question about the flow or impingement, then they would recapture the valve and protect the coronary. Obviously, that is a debate, but this is something that can be discussed.
How about the test of dye injection during pre-valvuloplasty?
Yeah, well,
useful?
Yeah, you can do that. You can do the valvuloplasty. In this case, quite frankly, we decided not to pre-dilate. So this is always a good test in case you're worried about it, particularly with a small sinus. You can do the valvuloplasty and see how the leaflets move up against the coronary. But since I'm not so much worried about the sinus, the leaflet here will probably be pushed into the sinus. And we tried to do the case without pre-dilatation, therefore we leave it. But that's a very good point.
Can I make a couple just quick points? I think, Eberhard, you raised all the relevant issues. I think the risk is less because the sinuses are large, especially if you're using a 26 Evolut. The calcium is most on the right coronary cusp and not the left. So I think the left, if you look at the CT, has less calcium. That, again, lowers the risk. In terms of BAV and looking during BAV, I think that's a reasonable option. I guess the challenge here is there's a fair amount of AR to start, so that increases the risk of a BAV. But the one thing about the Evolut, though, at 80%, you can't get a true assessment of where the valve is going to push the leaflet to because it's still constrained by the capsule, because it can give you a false sense of security, because we've done that and we've had sort of late occlusion after. So I think you have to be cautious about that. I think you get some idea of where the leaflet's going, but I think it's not absolute. The one question I had for you, with low-lying coronaries with the Evolut, do you tend to position it just a touch deeper so it's on that taper portion and the leaflet's not pushed as far over, or do you deploy it exactly the same?
Well, I mean, I can only speak for myself, Sushil, and of course, Dr. Hahn, and you know, you can argue. I would probably not do it any higher. I would probably deploy it the regular way. However, Sushil, you brought up a very important point that nobody has touched upon, and that's the valve size. Now, the valve size, given the perimeter of, I think it was 72.3, is right on the edge between the 26 and the 29. And you can argue either way. Personally, I would take the 29. You just mentioned the 26. We'll see. We've chosen now to select the 29 valve and see how that goes. Because I'm looking not only at the annulus area, but also at the ascending aorta, and that is a big aortic root and a large aortic root, and it's a big anatomy altogether. So my tendency would be, and given the AI that we have here, I would tend more towards a 29 over a 26. But again, that can also be discussed.
As you can see here in the table, actually, there is a huge discrepancy but based on the area or based on the perimeter. Maybe there is some the fault in the measuring the perimeter, because there is the line is not straight. The perimeter size is quite different from the area derived diameter. The difference is too huge in this case.
No, but for the self-expanding ones, usually for the perimeter instead of the area.
Yeah, I think the chart is a little misleading. We usually don't use the area too much in self-expanding ones.
Eberhard, Paul here.
Hi.
I want to listen to your thoughts on the embolic protection.
On embolic protection? Well, you know my thoughts about that. Here you have, given the calcium score, you have severe calcifications. I would, as you know, unless we have an area or we have patients clearly defined at risk, I would protect all patients. Particularly, I mean, this patient has severe calcifications. The arch looks good, but he's 91 years old, so I would, in my practice, I would protect the brain in this patient.
Regarding embolic protection, usually atherosclerosis of aorta in oriented people is less than that in Caucasian. Furthermore, aortic arch system is very thin and soft. Thus, I think the instance of stroke would be less after aortic arch than other two bigger systems.
That's all that's all true. We know the numbers, but again, a stroke is a stroke.
So I'm going to ask Keith a question here. So, you know, this discussion of, you know, the lotus valve may be not so sort of suitable here. What do you think in terms of the placement? Obviously, talking about, you know, you should try high, but here because of the corner being low, what are your thoughts?
Well, I think the sinus is are a good size. So although there's been a lot of emphasis on the low left coronary artery, the sinuses are large.
Big enough, yeah.
So I think, you know, when we looked formally in the pivotal trial and the other LOTUS trials, coronary occlusion is very uncommon with a LOTUS valve, as long as you're integrating in your thought process the size of the sinus and the height of the coronary.
I think this case is very educational compared to the previous cases. It is not a simple case. We know that in the previous cases, the STS score is a low risk. It's just a simple procedure. However, in these cases, first of all, clinical aspect, patient number is the 91. And second one is a valve area is very tightest, 0.47. Very tightest. It is the high risk of something happen, and there is a very severe calcium. So before the start the TAVI procedure, we have to know that this case is a really, really high risk. The previous the case is a low risk. So therefore, we carefully look at that. And the second one is the height from the annulus to the ostium. Oh. Direct stenting. Okay, anyhow, it's, when they introduced the evolute valve, across the aortic valve, there is some chance of the compromise of the blood flow from the LV to the aorta. So we don't have much time to the hesitate.
So you selected the 29.
So.
Yeah, we selected the 29. Let you guys tell us what you're going to do.
Let me just tell you two things. First of all, he did a beautiful job implanting it with the inline sheath. So true 18 French OD went in very nicely. You know, you came across nicely. We tested the valve beforehand, and whether you know the paddles are in the pouches. So everything is good. And now,
during the deployment, could you show us the hemodynamic status simultaneously?
Yeah, there's one more thing that I would like to mention here. That's the wire, and the usually. You know, in our practice, we use the pre-shaped wires, either Safari or the Quonfeeder. Here, unfortunately, the Safari or the Quonfeeder is not available. So he did a beautiful job pre-shaping it. So this is the super stiff wire now. And basically, I think if we can do it, maybe a little injection to see where we are, the sign, okay. The
contrast tip.
So okay. The position is good as far as the pigtail is concerned. And now I try to deploy, I'm deploying, but I do this slowly. Now this is new for Dr. Ahn, I have to say, because he's working with SJ, and SJ and slow is something that doesn't combine very well. So
we can see from first case, yeah.
Yeah, you could see that. So I'm slow, as long as the pressure is good, and as long as she gives me a go, I will go.
So you can see the sheath is now obviously pulled back and exposing the 6 millimeters of the Evolut R that you can.
Don't go too high.
The depth is perfect.
Yeah. It looks good if you could keep that now, and I would usually support with the wire a little bit. Keep that height. This is excellent. Keep it.
Now you want to engage the annulus, yeah.
You see it sort of centering itself a little bit there. Yeah.
Because it was a little too low on, it would start to, yes. Now it's going to go a little bit faster to get to 2/3 and maybe the pressure will come back up.
Let the pressure come up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you don't need any rapid pacing during the deployment?
No. And can we go maybe a little bit higher with the rate?
Yeah, you can pace it in a slightly higher rate to sort of stabilize the valve a little bit. Maybe a little picture for us, Eberhard?
Yes, just once. Beautiful. So, you know, look at the non-coronary depth is about 2 to 4. This is an excellent job that he did on the coronary, so on the left side. It's a little deeper, but remember when we deploy, the valve will... rock back, and the other side might come up. Everybody
so
okay?
In this situation, do you still do a little layover? Do you try to push the valve a little over to help it straighten, or do you just let it be?
Yeah. Yeah, so look at the coronaries. We kind of lose that a little bit out of sight. Can we replay? So it's pretty good at this point anyway. So I would personally lay over a little bit more,
right,
in order to not let the valve jump up. Push
in a bit.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. Excellent.
Okay.
Slowly. Yep.
Good.
So the two pedals come off, and you can see that's on the top. And
okay,
excellent.
Okay,
wire.
So
Steve, wire.
You can see actually two things.
Wire.
I approach the you know, the nose cone to the device.
Yeah, wire back in a bit.
The diastolic pressure is better than before. The diastolic pressure is good at this point. It's 45, 48. Let it give a little bit of time. And yeah, can we just, not for PVR, but can we do it a little bit higher, the pigtail, a little bit higher,
yes,
into the crown? Yeah, can we do the angiogram now? I just want to look at the coronaries.
Heart rate, high shift. Contrast.
Too high,
too small.
Yeah, yeah, it's too high. Don't worry. We will do the right thing. Don't worry. Okay, so this, the coronary looks good. Would you agree with that?
Yeah. Yes, can you play back again, so we can...
I think this is a very good case for the use of the evolute arm in case of the lower length of the from the annulus to the ostium. Before the angiogram, there is no ECG change or hemodynamic status. So we can easily know that there is no acute left main occlusion.
So guys, any comments from your side? So the diastolic pressure, well, it's a tachycardia, so it's 53. But we let it slow down a little bit. But I think the depth is very good.
Yes.
It doesn't look like there's a lot of PVL. Maybe we can have the echo. I don't know whether they are available here or not.
I think you did excellent the job, and we considered that the patient age is 91 years old, so the result is just acceptable. I'd like to just let it alone without further aggressive management.
Yeah, and you know what? You remember, there was a lot of calcium. It doesn't look like we need to post-dilate, depending on echo, obviously. But there's not much PVL that I can see here. As I said, the depth looks good. And even if the inflow is a little bit non-circular, you know, it's superannular insertion of the leaflets is going to be round.
Is the pressure linkage now, at 2 o'clock?
I'm sorry?
How about 2 o'clock?
2 o'clock
small,
what?
Small leakage?
Small, yeah.
I think it's mostly in the sinus, but Eberhard, I think that's a beautiful result. The depth is perfect, and also if you look in that sinus image, you and the team were absolutely correct. You look at the left main, from the stent to the left main, there's plenty of distance if you come up a little bit.
Yeah. Sushil, also, I mean, if you look, don't you think that the 29 was a good choice?
Yeah. No, yes. I completely agree. It looks great here.
I think 26 will be a little too small, Eberhard.
Yeah.
And it will be leaking
this
a bit.
This is Dr. Gunn again, and I'm happy you are right about the sizing.
But I think even a sinus is pretty good size, you know, S3 will be okay here too. Yeah. I don't see any big issue. Do you?
No.
So, Paul, are you okay with that too?
Yeah, I think the position cannot be any better.
Yeah.
You see, you begin with a moderate to severe AI with very low diastolic pressure, but now it's almost essentially non-AI.
Yeah.
So I think the result is perfect.
How about, okay. How about AV conduction? If you can
reduce
the number of preset of backup pacemaker, we can see more clearly the AV conduction status.
So he goes down.
I'll ask Dr. An, what do you do with the pacemaker here in Evolut R at Assan Medical Center? Do you keep it for, or if there's no issue, do you take them out, or do you actually prophylactically keep it for a day or two?
Yes, one day. One day we will keep the temporary pacemaker and conduction is okay. We will put it out. Patient just stay CCU at one day and then go up to the general ward.
So look at the EKG.
Look at this. It's patient EKG. Perfectly sinus rhythm.
Sinus.
Yes. No conduction block.
Perfect. Perfect.
Well, for 91 or 92 years old, that's pretty good. That's EKG with the conduction.
I'd like to ask you more about the sizing. Actually, Edwards decide the device size depending on the area, annulus area, but core valve depending on the parameter.
Yes.
Why is that?
I think the mechanism of the expansion is different, right? One, you have a balloon expandable. The other one is a self-expanding. So I think, I think for the self-expanding one, you should choose according to the perimeter.
Everything, as far as sizing is concerned, everything that is circular has to go by area, the sapien and the lotus. Everything that is non-circular oval or ellipsoid, should go by perimeter like portico or core valve or any other self-expanding.
Yeah.
Okay, gentlemen, the patient has been on the table quite a while. Thank you very, very much.
Excellent.
I think we're done.
Excellent job, Eberhard and Dr. An. Thank you very much.
Dr. An, thank you very much.
Thank you, Eberhard.
It was great. Thank you.
Let's go back to the first room.
Yep.
Dr. Yun?
Yes.
Dr. Yun, can you show us the final angio?
Could you show me the final angio?
Was there any reduction of leakage after final S3?
After 5 minutes. Can you see that final angio?
No, we cannot see. And, please show us the angio.
I'm going to.
Okay.
Final angio.
Okay, we can see.
Yes. And then our view?
No significant change.
Yeah, so how do you think? Let's say mild.
Yeah, minimal leakage.
Yeah, minimal. So this is the final angio. And also, echo shows the trivial parabola leakage at final. And there's no bleeding. So there's no vascular complications.
That's good.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Great job, Dr. Yun. Yep.
감사합니다.
Any questions from the panel? Maybe these two cases. Yeah. Anybody want to comment before we go to lectures?
I'm sorry. Keep asking about the sizing. The self-expanding parameter, balloon expanding area, is that real? Is that right? I don't think so, actually. Because Edwards don't use the parameter because there are a lot of the miscalculation. If a line is not straight, it can oversize. It's like this case. It's not because of ellipticity. This case was not so elliptical. This is, I think this is a kind of a philosophy.
I think as you get more elliptical, there's more variation in
area
than perimeter.
Of course, that's right.
And part of it is historically we've sized by area and sort of gotten into the habit and we knew what areas translated. I think for balloon expandable it works because the balloon circularizes as much as possible that space. You know, ideally it probably would have been better by perimeter, but just historically what we've always done is by area for balloon expandable.
Balloon expandable can make the valve circular.
No.
That should depend on the perimeter, not the area.
No, but that you have to remember that for a self-expanding one, you have to have some sort of oversizing. Yeah. Otherwise, the device cannot be fixed to the position.
Yeah, of course.
So for the self-expanding ones, the oversizing with the same diameter, of course, the oversizing is less than the balloon expandable one.
The because oversizing is, of course, called coil, but the self-expanding parameter is the vice versa, on the contrary, actually.
But I think actually the two obviously are related, right? So the area and the perimeter, whether it's circular, whether it's elliptical, but just question of, I think, you know, historically you use these charts to do certain valves, and there's a range still. No matter what, it's not that precise to the point that, you know, you say one is absolute. So I think it's a bit, becomes a habit and the way things done.
This last case, Eberhard and his team's case was perimeter 72. It's in the gray zone of 26 versus 29. Ideally, you want 10 to 11% oversizing by perimeter for self-expanding.
Yeah.
At 72, it was 12%. So you could argue to go either way. But because the sinuses were big and more oversizing, the U.S. Pivotal trial showed that with higher degrees of oversizing, especially by over 15% by perimeter, you had less PVL rates.
I have one safety issue. In the second case, there is definite low height of left main, just 7.5 millimeters. But he didn't do anything, just deploy the valve. Thus, there are several factors to determine coronary obstruction. The valve type, Saipan is more frequent associated with obstruction. The second one is height. Third one is space of coronary sinus. Fourth is valve leaflet or cushion chunk on the left coronary cusp. But we cannot expect the final results, obstruction or none. In this case, how about your personal strategy? Eberhard just aggressively do implanting valve without any pre-test or without any pre-engagement guiding catheter to left main?
Our practice is that we have pretty much, unless it's really super high risk, we have not sort of protected it in a routine situation. So we would have just deployed it the same way and maybe checking a few times, but not really have it engaged with a wire or guide.
I think the issue here is that even though the coronary takeoff is low, but the sinus is big, and you are choosing an Evolu R, so you have a potential space in between the valve and the coronary ostium. And also it's Evolu R, so you always have the chance to resheath and reposition or even take it out, use another device. So I think that's a combination of things.
I think I was talking to Sashu that we'd be comfortable in S3 in this situation as well.
And I think the question of which device is a personal preference, and this idea that the rates are definitely higher with balloon expandable over self-expanding, we've got to be cautious about those things because that's from a registry, you know, multi-center registry, and CoreValve at that time was doing more CT sizing, so they probably screened out better, whereas with Sapiens we were doing less CT sizing. In the partner trial, the occlusion rates were comparable, 0.4%. So I'm not sure that it's better with one device versus another. I think it's what your personal preference is, what the risks are, and how you manage it. And I think you'd be comfortable with either device depending on your experience.
I think it's not which one is better than which one, but it's the result of the deployment.
Correct.
Because using a balloon expandable, if you have an occlusion, you have an occlusion. There's no way, no turning back. So it's probably better to have a safe
line. But the thing is, like when he made the assessment of the coronaries, your frame is constrained. You're not pushing the leaflet to where it's going to end up.
No.
So unless it's like a Lotus where you can fully deploy and assess, you can't assess the coronaries with the Evolute at 80% because you've constrained the frame and you don't push the leaflets over.
So and angles are a little different too. The final resting angles of while the valve is sitting. So.
And there is this phenomenon of, you know, we've had a case of an occlusion about 20 minutes after deployment because there is some continued expansion.
Yes.
And so, you know, there are scenarios and, you know, I think you have to screen high-risk anatomy carefully and in a case like that might wait for a little while as well.
Agree.
I think the size of the sinus and really how bulky is that leaflet on that side is usually the best way we can tell because you can see if there's no sinus, a little bit of valve is going to block off everything, but if enough sinus circulation will go around and still be able to perfuse. And I think, you know, again, that's probably something that we should pay more attention to as well.
Alec, can I have a very quick question for you? For the second case that valve is so heavily calcified, will you just do, just like Abraham did, without any balloon dilatation, you do direct stenting right away, even with the core valve?
Generally, in a core valve, we don't do pre-dilatation. We just do it the way that what has been done in this case. I think, obviously, the valve is very tight, but you know, both cases has a bit of AI, so I think it's a little bit exaggeration of the gradient because of the increased flow across the aortic valve, but we generally don't pre-dilate the when we use the Evolute system. I don't know what other operators do here.
No, we don't
need same here.
We generally feel that there's a little valve that's actually holding the system a little bit better than when you really over it and the leaflet is sort of distorted and things are, I think it's not as stable to me somehow.
Usually we do not pre-dilate that core valve, but when introduced the core valve without the pre-dilation, blood pressure was suddenly dropped that the 80 to the 90 to the 50. It does not make any the enough time for the deployment at that time, pull back of the and then waiting for and that give the enough time for the patient to the recovery of the heart function and then carefully deploy it and then more rapidly.
Our hospital strategy of pre-deal is 100% pre-deal for Sapien, about 0.5%, about 50% pre-deal in case of Lotus or Evolutal. If there is a possibility of coronary obstruction or there is a kind of gray zone of sinus, size of annulus relative to valve, then we always perform a pre-deal with balloon inflation and dye injection.
Okay, thank you. I think we're going to move on to our lecture.